apparently this is going to be it for the current incarnation of Marvel X-Men movies from that we've known from pretty much the year 2000 up until now. So pretty much 20 years worth of films all coming to an end right here.
It's kind of sad.
It is kind of, yeah. Which, okay, I'm going to be honest with you. For the most part, I've loved the hell out of these films. With several exceptions. X-Men The Last Stand is okay. It's not the best thing. Still not the worst thing, but it's okay. X-Men Origins Wolverine. I think that's really all I have to say on that. The Wolverine was awesome all the way up until the third act. Where, don't get me wrong, I loved seeing the Silver Samurai come to life on screen, but still, just overall disappointed with the finale. That being, X-Men Apocalypse was a little bit too jumbled of a mess, but I still thought it was a good film.
I liked Apocalypse.
I did too. I mean, it for the most part, I thought it was really good. Now, the amount of great films that has come out of this franchise, the first X-Men movie, which I think a lot of people had their doubts about, but still for some reason worked very well. And then you had X-Men 2, X-Men United, which pretty much was an improvement over the original and blew everyone away in terms of its, in terms of the special effects, the storytelling, and I think that's the film where everyone fell in love with Hugh Jackman as Wolverine. I mean, they liked him in the first film, and he fit perfectly. But the second film is where a lot of people really got a taste for his character. And then we had X-Men: Last Stand, which, you know, love it or hate it, I still thought it was okay. And then we went into a bit of an unsure future after that, because apparently after that there was a whole thing, would they ever make another X-Men movie? And then they did X-Men Origins, which was X-Men Origins Wolverine, which was not good, and that cast even more doubt on top of it. And then they did X-Men First Class, and then we had a whole new continuum to fit into this whole thing. With a young Charles Xavier, a young Magneto, and a young Mystique, all just doing their thing and telling actually a pretty damn good story. And then we had X-Men Days of Future Past. Did you ever see it?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
So, I was unsure how they were going to pull it off. You know, merging the two timelines together and then eventually finishing them out. I was not disappointed. I was actually blown away by how well they were able to tell the story, this massively complex story, and how they were able to put it together and make everything just work. And then we had Logan. God damn, what a movie.
Yeah.
A gut-wrenching, heartbreaking, final magnum opus of a tribute to the character Wolverine. And the fact it wasn't, that Hugh Jackman didn't get an Oscar nomination, I'm still pissed about.
So when you say this is the end to this X-Men run,
yes,
does that mean there's no follow-up to the kids from the end of Wolverine?
I don't know. They're talking about doing it. Yeah, you see, the talks for that were going all the way up until Disney bought 20th Century Fox.
Yeah.
And
you think there's a chance they could pick it up and do something with it?
Potentially, yes. Okay. I believe if if anything, Disney will pick it up and continue on that.
So that would be cool, because that was a big, like, I wonder what's going to go down with this, you know?
Yeah, and also, if we continue the story of X-23, I'd be up for that, because she was awesome. She was very awesome.
Isn't the, is it the New Mutants? Is that what it's called? There's like a R-rated looking like horror style like set in this universe coming out.
I think that's something to do with the X-Men, but I'm not 100% sure on that. I haven't really looked into it.
I was thinking it was supposed to be at least set in the same universe or whatever, like the Marvel Universe.
I don't know.
I'm not sure.
I don't know.
I'm actually kind of excited about that one, though. It looks kind of cool.
I'll have to look at that and see what it's all about. But Dark Phoenix is coming out here soon, and it looks like they're pretty much going to go out guns blazing with this franchise. So I guess let's just get it on screen and let's see what happens. Hi, Jean.
Why did you make me do that? Look at me. Focus on my voice. I'm not giving up on you, Jean. She was my friend. You're my family, Jean. Stop. No matter what. Stop. Stop. Look. You're special, Jean. And if you stop fighting that force inside you, if you embrace it, he will possess the very power of a god.
She'll kill us all.
Oh, damn.
Tell me how we fix this, Charles. Tell me what to do. I don't know what to do.
What they don't understand, they fear, and what they fear, we seek to destroy.
Hell yeah.
This is your fault, Charles. I tried to protect her.
I'm scared. When I lose control, bad things happen to people I love.
A girl dies.
She's still Jean. We can still help her.
Sometimes you want to believe people are something that they are not. By the time you realize who they are.
Oh boy.
Jean!
It's too late.
That's wicked.
Yeah.
So, okay.
This looks badass.
It does. It looks very badass. And I don't know what the hell's going to happen. Because, okay, the outcome of the Dark Phoenix saga, how it all went down... in the comics, there was actually several continuums where the Dark Phoenix came in, but I think the one that I'm seeing here is she pretty much absorbs the Phoenix Force, and it pretty much overtakes her. It overtakes her abilities, and she becomes pretty much, as you see here, a god in a human body, and holy shit. I mean, she already had a tremendous amount of abilities with it, as we saw in Apocalypse. You know, she pretty much was the reason why Apocalypse lost.
Yeah.
She was the one that pretty much broke him down. And then we have, God, dude, there's just so much to unravel with this. I mean, from what it looks like, I think they're going to kill Mystique. That's what it looked like, anyway.
It could be. They could kill a lot of the characters in this, just depending on how they do the timeline with it.
Well, yeah, because this is now that they've wrapped up Days of Future Past, this is a completely different timeline from what we got in the main line.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking that this is going to be, well, depending on how they go about it, if they kill off, because it looked like she was killing off Magneto with the whenever she was crushing his helmet, and then of course there's always the chance that she kills Scott, and that's what breaks the Phoenix's control over her because of the death of Scott Summers, which was also in the comics one of the triggers that actually caused her to fight back against the Phoenix. I just don't know what they're going to do. I'm still intrigued beyond measure as to how they're going to wrap this side of the story up. And also, damn, Sansa Stark, you scary.
Mm-hmm. Also very, very cute.
Well, yeah, she's a very, she's always been a very pretty woman, all the way. Yeah, and now you know how tall she is.
Can't remember.
She's like 5'10". She's pretty tall.
Huh. She's like pretty the same height as me.
Yeah, could you imagine that? Hmm? You and her standing next to each other, just like, damn, you tall.
I actually dated a girl that was like taller than me and a girl that was the same height as me, so.
Never dated a girl as tall as me, I've never really dated a woman under 5'7". I don't know what it is. I guess I'm just into taller women.
I'm just into who I'm into.
Yeah. So let's go to the Wikipedia page. Okay, first off, let's leave a like on this video. Click. And let's leave a comment down here. If you all can find the comment, congratulations.
Is it me or does she look just like Sansa Stark?
There we go. There's a comment for you. See if you can find that. So let's go here to Wikipedia and let's go to The Dark Phoenix. There it is. So directed by Simon Kinberg, the same Simon Kinberg who wrote Days of Future Past. Awesome. So it's 1992 in this continuum. Okay. Nearly a decade after X-Men Apocalypse, the X-Men are national heroes going on increasingly risky missions. When a solar flare hits them during a rescue mission,
Jean Grey loses... Yes, explains the outfits.
Huh?
I guess that explains the outfits, like the uniforms.
Yeah. So
I was like, oh, they have uniforms again. Weird.
Yeah, well, that's one thing that always got me was the uniforms. I wasn't sure how they were going to handle uniforms, if they were going to do custom uniforms for each individual person, which they started to do in First Class, but then they sort of tapered off a little bit on it. And now it seems as though they're all going with the same universal uniform, which I'm okay with because it looks nice. But the fact they got everyone coming back for this, I mean, they got you know, James McAvoy, Michael Fassbender, Jennifer Lawrence, Nicholas Holt. Those have really been the main four who have stayed throughout the entire First Class universe. And of course, you have Quicksilver, who I gotta admit, every time
he's like my favorite character now, which I love Evan Peters in general. He's one of my favorite actors.
Oh yeah, recently. Evan Peters is just a
ever
fun
since
guy.
I saw American Horror Story, he's badass. He's badass in like basically every part he plays in American Horror Story, and he plays so many like completely different characters. Like he's got a very wide range for acting. He's an impressive dude.
Oh yeah, very impressive. I always liked him. And, of course, Cody Smith McPhee coming back as Nightcrawler. Nightcrawler, to me, one of the most underrated mutants, and to me, one of my favorites from when I was a kid. And also, one of his origin stories actually almost made me cry. It turns out he was a circus performer who fell in love with one of the the trapeze artists, a female, and she fell, and he saved her, and he fell in love with her and everything, and her father was the head of the circus and pretty much denied what they were doing and wanted him to stay away, and that if he didn't, he'd kill him. And anyway, the circus manager eventually gets fed up with all the stuff going on, and he decides to call up people who take care of mutants, in which he calls up William Stryker, and thus William Stryker comes and takes Nightcrawler away, and they pretty much put Nightcrawler in this dream scenario where they pretty much put him in a chair to pretty much give him all of the see what he's fully capable of, and also to dig deeper into his memories and everything. And it's actually sad to see just how much he just wanted to be accepted and loved in some way, because this was before he knew who his mother was, and before he knew like who he was as a person. And it was just heartbreaking to see that. And I would love to have seen more from the original Nightcrawler, Alan Cumming, when they had him playing him. But, it is what it is. But I'm excited to see this. I want to see this. Let us know what you all think.
A fun fact there that Turner studied dissociative identity disorder and schizophrenia for the role, particularly for scenes where she has to change from the vulnerable Jane to the confident Phoenix.
Well, yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, I would say probably for me, whenever actors include little snippets of different things into their performance to make the performance even better, that's great. You see, there's method actors who do shit like that, who no matter what, they stay in character, and then there are people who have to literally turn it on.
Yeah.
Like, whenever they turn it on, it goes, like, God, there's just so many things.
I don't know, I feel like if I were to act, that method acting would be very helpful to me, but I feel like it would be too weird to, like, just be that person all the time outside of filming, you know?
Well, Marlon Brando is probably one of the most infamous method actors. I mean, given everything that he did during his life, I mean, it's crazy to think about that. And also to me, like looking at Daniel Day-Lewis and how deep he dives himself into roles, there was actually a time during the filming of one film he did called The Boxer, where he portrays an Irish boxer who was on the road to becoming a national champion, but got embroiled up in this IRA scandal and got put in prison for like 5 to 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And after he gets out, he dedicates himself to actually boxing again and actually becomes more of a national hero because of him rising up and actually standing for peace. But yet his old ties to the IRA come back and pretty much tell him, no, you need to squash all this shit that, you know, we can live peacefully with the Protestants. We don't want that. And he's just like, no. Turns out Daniel Day-Lewis during that time actually took boxing matches in the underground circuit just to build up the experience for it. And according to reports, he fought 4 times. He won all 4 times, and he knocked out 3 of his opponents.
Damn.
People who get deep into some certain roles are crazy, but at the same time, if the work really stands up and shows to that level of dedication, I mean it. God.
And then you have like Jared Leto, who just doesn't fucking understand the character he's supposed to be method acting as.
I can respect the fact
pisses
that
everyone
he,
off as
well,
a result.
I can respect the fact that he tried, but at the same time, he didn't have to be such an intolerable asshole.
Yeah, well, it's like the Joker is not a fucking character that would send a used condom to someone.
No, to him, it would be, it has to be a joke. It has to be a literal, there's no joke to used condoms. There's no joke to it. There's instead just, like, if you wanted to, like, send it something, someone a joke or something, say, if you were on set talking to one of your castmates, and they said, oh, God, I really love Edith Piaf. I really love, like, Edith Piaf. And as a joke, you send them, or as it looks like you're, you know, doing a kindness to them, you send them a record that is in an Edith Piaf sleeve, has Edith Piaf stamped and pressed in the middle, but the very moment they turn it on, it's like the, it's
never
like,
gonna give you up.
Yeah, yeah, that's a good joke. You see, that's a joke. That's a joke that the Joker would pull on somebody.
Just like dough over, like, with it. Like,
yeah, like, all of a
like,
sudden.
So it's like, never gonna give you up, and just ha. And just it'd be like, son of a bitch.
Yes, exactly. And that'd be funny. That would be something that the Joker would do. Yeah. He wouldn't send you used condoms and just be like, sorry, I thought of you when I made these. Like, that's not funny. That's creepy. And the Joker, while having the mental instabilities that he does, he doesn't try to be creepy.
He's never been disgusting, like, so.
Well, he's been very abrasive, and he's been very, like, dark at times.
Yeah, but.
Like, the Killing Joke. I'd say the Killing Joke is probably the darkest the Joker's ever gotten. That was rough. That was a rough one for me. And, yeah. Well, anyway, we're still here talking about this for some reason. Okay, well, ladies.
We got lots of other stuff to do. So.
Oh, yeah, we got a lot of other stuff to watch, but. If you all are interested in the Dark Phoenix, Dark Phoenix, let us know in the comments down below. And also, don't forget to like, comment, subscribe. And until next time, everyone, I'm Nate.
I'm Nick.
And we'll see you then. Peace out.